Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray together the collect of this day. Grant to us, Lord, we pray, the spirit to think and do always those things that are right, that we, who cannot exist without you, may by you be enabled to live according to your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of 1 Kings. Elijah came to a cave and spent the night there. Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He answered, "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away." He said, "Go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by." Now there was a great wind, so strong that it was splitting mountains and breaking rocks in pieces before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a sound of sheer silence. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. Then there came a voice to him that said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He answered, "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away." Then the Lord said to him, "Go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. And when you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael as king over Aram. Also, you shall anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, as king over Israel. And you shall anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat of Abimelech, as prophet in your place. Whoever escapes from the sword of Hazael, Jehu shall kill. And whoever escapes from the sword of Jehu, Elisha shall kill. Yet I will leave 7,000 in Israel, all the knees that have not bowed to Baal, and every mouth that has not kissed him." The word of the Lord. The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 85, verses 8 through 13, found on page 709. We will say it together. I will listen to what the Lord God is saying, for he is speaking peace to his faithful people and to those who turn their hearts to him. Truly, his salvation is very near to those who fear him, that his glory may dwell in our land. Mercy and truth have met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. Truth shall spring up from the earth, and righteousness shall look down from heaven. The Lord will indeed grant prosperity, and our land will yield its increase. Righteousness shall go before him, and peace shall be a pathway for his feet.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Romans. Moses writes concerning the righteousness that comes from the law, that the person who does these things will live by them. But the righteousness that comes from faith says, "Do not say in your heart, 'Who will ascend into heaven?' That is, to bring Christ down. Or, 'Who will descend into the abyss?' That is, to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is, the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord, and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart, and so is justified. And one confesses with the mouth, and so is saved. The scripture says, "No one who believes in him will be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all and is generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. But how are they to call on one in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in one of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone to proclaim him? And how are they to proclaim him unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news." The word of the Lord.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew. Immediately he made the disciples get into a boat and go on ahead to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up to the mountain to pray. When evening came, he was there alone, but by this time the boat, battered by the waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning, he came walking towards them on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It is a ghost." And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid." Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came towards Jesus. But when he noticed the strong wind, he became frightened and began to sink. He cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshiped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Good morning. I've got to be honest with you, it's a difficult time in which to preach these days. This extended period of physical distancing because of the pandemic has really grown old. I'm tired of having a ridiculous discussion over whether or not wearing masks to protect our communal well-being is a violation of individual rights. Sure, while I've certainly enhanced some of my cooking skills over the last several months, I long to be able to go out to a restaurant and have a nice meal that I didn't have to make. Parents, students, and educators, they're all struggling with the extremely difficult challenge about how to provide safe learning environments for children as we begin another school year. Countless thousands are at the breaking point financially. Even our own parish is feeling the effects as a large number of our parishioners are behind on their pledge. Our dysfunctional political system has shown itself both incapable and almost completely disinterested in providing for the needs of its people and for the common good. So into this difficult world, it's a challenge to speak a word of hope. It's a challenge to see where the good news is. Today, our readings start off with the story of Elijah on Mount Horeb. Now, we need to pause for just a moment and think about what happened to get Elijah here in the first place. We need to remember that Elijah was a prophet during the 9th century BC under the most wicked monarchy in the history of Israel. In fact, if you think about it, Ahab and Jezebel, they've become so iconic in their wickedness that their names survive as the centerpiece for the great American novel. Think about Moby Dick's Ahab and the archetype for the femme fatale in our modern era. Anyway, we catch up with Elijah today in hiding, and he's on the run. Now, remember that Elijah had a flair for the dramatic. In his battle against the prophets of Baal, he went a bit overboard, calling down fire from heaven, killing the prophets. That really didn't go over so well with Jezebel, who was a devoted follower of Baal. And so she put a price on Elijah's head, and he's forced to flee into the wilderness of Judah outside of Jezebel's jurisdiction. Wandering alone, he sits down under a juniper tree to pout and to ask God to just let him die. Instead, the Lord sends an angel to feed him, and then refreshed and strengthened, Elijah goes on to Mount Horeb, the same mountain, by the way, where Moses encountered the burning bush. Elijah, he's caught up in despair and desolation and discouragement. But God comes and speaks to him and says, Elijah, what are you doing here? The mission has to go on. Now, of course, Elijah, he pours out all of the reasons that he wants to give up. But God says to him again, what are you doing here? The mission must go on. Only in the profound silence of God's presence does Elijah get up the nerve to dust himself off and head back into the fray. Paul, in the letter to the Romans, seems to echo the sentiments of Elijah in his own journey and tells the Romans that even in speaking the truth in Christ, his conscience joins with the Holy Spirit in witnessing that his great sorrow and constant anguish in his heart. Paul takes on the role of prophet and even offers himself up as a kind of scapegoat for the sake of his Israelite people. Paul is mindful of the cultic language with which the Romans and Israel are intimately familiar. And so in this reading, we sense that Paul has come to a certain reconciliation of his mission to the Gentiles and his own past as an Israelite cut off from his community, as well as his future to speak the truth in Christ. Both Paul and Elijah today have to discover God in the quiet acceptance of their own vocation. In the gospel, Jesus has just finished the 5,000 that we heard about last week. And so he sends the disciples ahead to cross the sea in a boat on their own, while he stays behind and dismisses the people and takes a little private time for prayer. The disciples, loaded up in the boat, which is a symbol of the church, face a chaotic storm while they're out on the sea. a reminder to us that the church also faces turbulent times. And also, to make matters even more alarming, in the wee hours of the morning, they look across the waves and they see a shadowy figure coming across toward them, and they think it's a ghost. Instead of recognizing the divine presence in silence, and yes, even in danger, echoing our story of Elijah, the disciples only recognize Jesus after the fact, and in the most dramatic of proofs. As usual, Peter is positioned as the target of a lackluster faith, if you are Jesus. And then, having stepped over the side of the boat and making his way toward Jesus, Peter allows his doubts to get the better of him, and he begins to sink. Let's stop and remember for a moment. Elijah called down fire from heaven to completely consume an overly wet altar. Paul, he had such a radical encounter with the risen Christ that he became an apostle, and he didn't really need the witness of the other apostles who had walked with Jesus. And the disciples, now they've been following Jesus for a while. They've just seen an incredible demonstration of the way that Jesus doesn't always do things the way we might expect. And Jesus takes just a few loaves and some fish, and he feeds 5,000 people with extra left over. But yet, fear and doubt persist. Elijah hides. Paul pouts. Peter sinks. So, what's the good news? We begin by recognizing and being honest about the fact that even the spiritual giants sometimes had to face trials and tribulations. So we're not unique. We're not somehow cosmically special. People before us have had great trials to face. But the readings for today are a gifted reminder that God remembers us. Elijah was fed and comforted and encouraged to continue his mission. Paul was strengthened in his conscience and his resolve by the Holy Spirit to keep pressing forward. And Jesus rescues the disciples from despair and death on the sea. The God in whom we live and move and have our being knows that we can't manage on our own. And so God continues calling to us, naming us as his beloved, feeding us in word and sacrament, and in stillness, and even in silence, God provides us the grace we need to continue the journey. The Holy Spirit continues guiding us forward. So today, the good news is that God is with us, even in the whispering wind, and yes, even in the terror of night. God continues to speak. God continues to call us forward. And when our feet begin to sink in doubt, Christ reaches out to grab hold of us and pull us up. Yeah, these are hard times. They're difficult times for so many people in so many different circumstances, but the mission must go on. And so today, in just a few moments, almost in an act of defiance, we will bless parents and students and educators. We will continue to look for ways to keep our community united. We will do all that we can to care for and support all of those in need. And we will continue to strive for justice and peace and the dignity of all. Because today we are reminded that we are God's beloved. And we have been given a purpose. We have been given a mission. And God is with us to bring that mission to its proper end. Thanks be to God. Let us profess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
We glory in God's name through the offering of our prayers and petitions, responding, "Hear us, good Lord." For the will to discover God's word dwelling in our hearts, finding expression through our lips, and revealing hope through our generosity, let us pray, saying, "Hear us, good Lord." For a renewed commitment to righteousness and peace, that we may join with the leaders of the nations in seeking ways to promote harmony in warring lands and mutual respect across cultures, races, and languages. Let us pray, saying, "Hear us, good Lord." For creative ways to express the faith, drawing upon the jewels of our tradition and using our hearts and minds to proclaim Christ's message to those of little faith or who have no faith at all. In the Anglican cycle of prayer this week, we pray for the Diocese of Mbomli, Nigeria, and Wa and Ibu, South Sudan. In our companion diocese of the Dominican Republic, we pray for Divina Providencia, San Antonio de Guerra. And in the Diocese of Georgia, we pray for Grace Church, Sandersville, and for our ecumenical partners in Sandersville, especially St. William's Catholic Church. Let us pray, saying, "Hear us, good Lord." For the sick, the suffering, and all in any need, especially Rosemary, Robert, and Judy, and all on our continuing prayer list. Are there others? Let us pray, saying, "Hear us, good Lord." That the summer months may provide opportunities for rest and refreshment, especially for our teachers and students, so that they may be rejuvenated for the challenges of an uncertain school year ahead. Let us pray, saying, "Hear us, good Lord." For medical personnel who provide services here and in foreign lands and amongst the most needy of the world, that we may lift our voices in praise for the good news they bring to others, and that they may be kept safe by the power of Jesus's healing love, let us pray, saying, "Hear us, good Lord." For our parish and discernment committee, that with the grace and energy of the Holy Spirit, we will prepare ourselves for what God is about in the discernment process, that we will see clearly and act with grace in concord with the Spirit. And for the person that God is already preparing to come to us, let us pray, saying, "Hear us, good Lord." For those who celebrate birthdays this week, especially Cassie, Natalie, Noel, Rachel, Jessica, Elaine, and Jeff, are there others? Let us pray, saying, "Hear us, good Lord." For those celebrating anniversaries this week, especially Les and Sally, are there others? Let us pray, saying, "Hear us, good Lord." For those who have died and reside in the tomb of death, especially Johnny, are there others? That Christ, who broke the chains of death, will bring them to eternal life. Let us pray, saying, "Hear us, good Lord." Ever increasing in faith, we offer our prayers and thanksgivings. Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, you are the source of all wisdom and knowledge. We know that you are ever present with us, but in the midst of so much fear and uncertainty, we really need your blessing this year. And so we turn to you to bless and keep safe those who seek to learn and those who are called to keep, as well as their families. Send forth your holy angels from heaven to guard, bless, cherish, and protect them from all danger, from all harm, from all sickness and disease. Let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, hear our prayer. For students, as they begin this new school year, whether in person or virtually, that the Spirit of God may grant them the gifts of wisdom and understanding. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For teachers and educators, that they may share their knowledge with gentleness, patience, and concern for their students. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For those who seek knowledge of the things of this world, that they may always pursue God's wisdom. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For parents, the first teachers of their children, that their faith and love may be an example to us always. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For all school and university workers, for their safety in carrying out their duties, that they may do their part in providing an environment of well-being. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord our God, in your wisdom and love, you surround us with the mysteries of the universe. In times long past, you sent us your prophets to teach us your laws and to bear witness to your undying love. You sent us your Son to teach us by word and example that true wisdom comes from your alone. Send your Spirit upon these students and their teachers and their families, and fill them with your wisdom and blessing. Grant them safety and protection, that during this academic year they may devote themselves to their studies and share what they have learned from others. Grant us, we pray, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving and make good your vows to the Most High. Give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
God of all power, ruler of the universe, you are worthy of glory and praise.
Glory to you forever and ever.
At your command, all things came to be. The vast expanse of interstellar space, galaxies, suns, the planets in their courses, and this fragile earth, our island home.
By your will, they were created.
From the primal elements, you brought forth the human race and blessed us with memory, reason, and skill. You made us the rulers of creation, but we turned against you and betrayed your trust, and we turned against one another.
Have mercy, Lord, for we are sinners in your sight.
Again and again, you called us to return. Through prophets and sages, you revealed your righteous law, and in the fullness of time, you sent your only son, born of a woman, to fulfill your law, to open for us the way of freedom and peace.
By his blood he reconciled us,
by his wounds we are healed.
And therefore we praise you, joining with the heavenly chorus, with prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with all those in every generation who have looked to you in hope, to proclaim with them your glory in their unending hymn.
This is
And so, Father, we who have been redeemed by you and made a new people by water and the Spirit, now bring before you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering now his work of redemption and offering to you the sacrifice of thanksgiving,
we celebrate his death and resurrection as we await the day of his coming.
Lord God of our fathers and mothers, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God of Sarah, Leah, and Rebecca, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world about us. Deliver us from the presumption of coming to this table for solace only and not for strength, for pardon only and not for renewal. Let the grace of this Holy Communion make us one body, one spirit in Christ, that we may worthily serve the world in his name.
Risen Lord, be most of us in the breaking of the bread.
Accept these prayers and praises, Father, through Jesus Christ, our great High Priest, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit, your Church gives honor, glory, and worship from generation to generation. As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
Spiritual communion. In union, blessed Jesus, with the faithful gathered at every altar of your Church, where your blessed body and blood are offered this day, and remembering particularly my own parish, I long to offer praise and thanksgiving for creation and all the blessings of this life, for the redemption won for us by your life, death, and resurrection, for the means of grace and the hope of glory. and particularly for the blessings given me. I believe that you are truly present in the Holy Sacrament, and since I cannot at this time receive communion, I pray you to come into my heart. I unite myself with you and embrace you with all my heart, my soul, and my mind. Let nothing separate me from you. Let me serve you in this life until, by your grace, I come to your glorious kingdom and unending peace. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. The peace which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day and remain with you always. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.